بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إقرارا به وتوحيدا وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا أما بعد قال الحافظ العلامة شيخ الإسلام الثاني ابن قيم الجوزية رحمه الله تعالى وفي غض البصر عدة منافع أحدها أنه امتثال لأمر الله الذي هو غاية سعادة العبد في معاشه ومعاده وليس للعبد في دنياه وآخرته أنفع من امتثال أوامر ربه تبارك وتعالى وما سعد من سعد في الدنيا والآخرة إلا بامتثال أوامره وما شقي من شقي في الدنيا والآخرة إلا بتضييع أوامره الثاني أنه يمنع من وصول أثر السم المسموم الذي لعل فيه هلاكه إلى قلبه الثالث أنه يورث القلب أنسا بالله وجمعية على الله فإن إطلاق البصر يفرق القلب ويشتته ويبعده من الله وليس على العبد شيء أضر من إطلاق البصر فإنه يوقع الوحشة بين العبد وبين ربه الرابع أنه يقوي القلب ويفرحه كما أن إطلاق البصر يضعفه ويحزنه الخامس أنه يكسب القلب نورا كما أن إطلاقه يكسبه ظلمة ولهذا ذكر سبحانه آية النور عقيب الأمر بغض البصر فقال قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم ويحفظوا فروجهم ثم قال إثر ذلك الله نور السماوات والأرض مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح أي مثل نوره في قلب عبده المؤمن الذي امتثل أوامره واجتنب نواهيه وإذا استنار القلب أقبلت وفود الخيرات إليه من كل جانب كما أنه إذا أظلم أقبلت سحائب البلاء والشر عليه من كل مكان فما شئت من بدعة وضلالة واتباع هوى واجتناب هدى وإعراض عن أسباب السعادة واشتغال بأسباب الشقاوة فإن ذلك إنما يكشفه له النور الذي في قلب فإذا فقد ذلك النور بقي صاحبه كالأعمى الذي يجوس في حنادس الظلام السادس أنه يورث الفراسة الصادقة التي يميز بها بين المحق والمبطل والصادق والكاذب وكان شجاع الكرماني يقول من عمر ظاهره باتباع السنة وباطنه بدوام المراقبة وغض بصره عن المحارم وكف نفسه عن الشهوات واعتاد أكل الحلال لم تخطي له فراسة وكان شجاع هذا لا تخطي له فراسة والله سبحانه يجزي العبد على عمله بما هو من جنس عمله ومن ترك شيئا لله عوضه الله خيرا منه فإذا غض بصره عن محارم الله عوضه الله بأن يطلق نور بصيرته عوضا عن حبسه ببصره لله ويفتح له باب العلم والإيمان والمعرفة والفراسة الصادقة المصيبة التي إنما تنال ببصيرة القلب وضد هذا ما وصف الله به اللوطية من العمى الذي هو ضد البصيرة فقال تعالى لعمرك إنهم لفي سكرتهم يعمهون فوصفهم بالسكرة التي هي فساد العقل والعمى الذي هو فساد البصر فالتعلق بالسور يوجب فساد العقل وعمه البصيرة يسكر القلب كما قال القائل إلى آخر كلامه رحمه الله Ibn Qayyim, he says, in lowering the gaze, there are several benefits, several things, fruits that you reap when you lower your gaze. Whether you're a female, whether you're a male, whether you're married, whether you're single, whether you have one wife, whether you have four wives, whether you're in college, whether you're in high school, whether you're watching something on your phone, your tablet, the television screen, a person walking down the street, down the hallway, Ibn al-Qayyim, he says, lowering the gaze will reap and render several benefits. The most important of these benefits and the sweetest of these fruits, he says, are 10. 10 fawaid of not looking at everything, not watching everything, not gazing at every single thing that you may desire and crave. The first fawaid that he says is you implementing and complying to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are obeying Allah, the Mighty and the Majestic. And this is the main reason, if not the reason, behind all happiness in this life and in hereafter. And the opposite is the reason behind all miserableness, all suffering in this life and in the hereafter. Jarir ibn Abdullah al-Bajri radiallahu anhu narrated that he asked the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam an nadhr al-fija'a. I asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam on an incidental look. I look up and I see something. I see a woman. I see something I shouldn't look at. Not intentionally, but by accident. Someone passes by, someone approaches me and I look. What should I do, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, Isrif basarak. He says, put your head down. Turn your eyes away. So if there was no faida, and you lowering your gaze, and you avoiding looking and staring and gawking at these things, except for the fact that it is you being an obedient slave, that will be sufficient. Why have I chosen this topic? What does this have to do with the conference? What does this have to do with part two of my first discussion or my first conversation with you? We say that the two go hand in hand. Why do people fall into vice when it comes to sexuality? How does a person become addicted to pornography? How does a person know that this girl is pretty and cute? And this boy, I want him to be my boyfriend. I can't get married. My culture prevents me from getting married. My culture prevents me from having a boyfriend. So on and so on and so on and so forth. Except because of the gaze. Except because of the eyes. What you look at. Is it permissible to study in a free mixed college? The question comes up all of the time. Can I go to school in the West? There are boys, there are girls, a professor, a male and a female, the eyes. Is it permissible to watch movies in Islam? The eyes. Is it permissible for a male to teach a sister? The eyes. Is it permissible, is it permissible, is it permissible? And this is why the non-Muslims themselves, they say, the eyes are the gateway to the soul. The eyes are the gateway to the soul. What you look at determines how you feel, how you think. How you feel, how you think, it determines what you physically do. As Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated in Sahih Bukhari, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, كُتِبَ عَلَى بِنِ آدَمَ حَظَّهُ أَوْ نَصِيبُهُ مِنَ الزِّنَا مُدْرِكُ ذَلِكَ وَلَا مَحَلَى. He says, the son of Adam has his set portion of zina. And he will reach this one way or another. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, أَلْعَيْنَانِ تَزْنِيَانِ أَوَ الْعَيْنَانِ تَزْنِيَانِ وَزِنَاهُمَ النَّظَرِ. He says, the eyes make zina, fornicate. And the fornication of the eyes is in looking. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned other body parts, other things that take place, what people do, not the actual physical act of sex. He then said at the end of this hadith, وَالْقَلْبُ يَتَمَنَّى وَالْفَرْجُ يُصَدِّقُ ذَلِكَ أَوْ يُكَذِّبُهُ. He says, once the eyes look, once the ears listen, once the mouth, the tongue moves, once the hands move, he says, وَالْقَلْبُ يَتَمَنَّى. The heart wishes, the heart craves, because I looked at this girl for 6 months because she's my classmate. Because I've been looking at this movie, I've been watching this person for the last 3, 4, 5 years. So my heart feels a certain type of way. وَالْفَرْجُ يُصَدِّقُ ذَلِكَ أَوْ يُكَذِّبُهُ. And the sexual organ, your private part, is the last frontier. It is the thing that translates those images, those feelings, those emotions, that lust, that love, or whatever you want to call it. The private area is the thing that translates all of those thoughts and emotions into deeds or doesn't translate them at all. The last final step. So the first faida of lowering the gaze, which is considered to be a major concept of this whole entire topic, of this whole entire conference. How many people have went astray because they looked at things, they watched things that they weren't supposed to? And this is my golden advice to all of the shabab. My golden advice to all of the youth is protect your eyes. When you're watching movies, when you're playing a video game, when you go outside, when you go to school, when you're watching sports, protect your eyes. Be mindful of that which you look at, because it only takes one look. It only takes 5 minutes. It only takes one film that you watch that could destroy the rest of your life and can be a major means of suffering, pain, and agony until you become a grown up, quote unquote. So be mindful of that which you look at. Be mindful in 2016 and 2017 of that which comes on the television screen. Parents, be mindful of that which your children watch and look at. Mothers, fathers, guardians, you have to be jealous for your children. And it's not okay to say, oh, just let them watch it. Oh, it's all right. Oh, don't be too harsh. Oh, don't be too strict. I can't keep up with them. It is your job
It is your responsibility not only to be mindful, not only to give advice, but to Islamically enforce the concept of lowering the gaze. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, الثاني, the second benefit of lowering the gaze, أَنَّهُ يَمْنَعُ مِنْ وُصُولِ أَثِرِ السُّمِّ الْمَسْمُومِ الَّذِي لَعَلَّ فِيهِ هَلَاكَهُ إِلَىٰ قَلْبِهِ. He says, lowering the gaze is considered to be the vest. It's the breastplate. It's the shield that screens you from the poison-tipped arrow. The arrow that is launched at you, that is hurled at you from your enemy, Shaytan. And not only is it an arrow, it's going to pierce through your tender flesh and to your vital organs, but it is tipped with poison. It's tipped with poison. In other words, metaphorically speaking, when you look at something that you can't have, initially, it is a means of you punishing yourself. When you look at something that you cannot have, initially, it is a means of you doing anything that you can to get that thing, because the poison is now inside of your bloodstream. The picture, the image, the beauty, the handsomeness, the desire for this thing or for this person is now inside your heart and in your mind. It's haram. It has major cultural repercussions. It's going to destroy my family, my relationship with my father, so on and so forth, my career, my studies, my scholarship. But at the end of the day, when I lay down and I go to sleep at night, that poison is still in my bloodstream. And all of those things are secondary when it comes to me fulfilling that which I've lusted upon with my eyes. So Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, be smart, avoid the arrow, avoid the poison, avoid the sum that is going to pierce your chest and go into the rest of your body. The third faida, he says, أَنَّهُ يُورِثُ الْقَلْبَ أُنْسًا بِاللَّهِ وَجَمْعِيَةً عَلَى اللَّهِ, is that it causes the heart to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It allows the human being's mind and his heart to be collective, to be focused upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is because, فَإِنَّ إِطْلَاقَ الْبَصْرِ يُفَرِّقُ الْقَلْبَ وَيُشَتِّتُهُ وَيُبْعِدُهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Looking at everything, even if it's not haram, even if it's not disliked, it separates, it splits, it divides your focus and your concentration, and it turns you far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's make an example of this. Why do the people who live in rural countries, rural lands, far from technology, far from modern products, modern propaganda, advertisement, why do they memorize so much more than those who have smartphones, those who have tablets, those who have easy access to pens, to paper, to pads, to writing things down? Advertisement, commercial, food, drink, movie, sports, superstar, this one, that one, actor, actress, hockey season, basketball, baseball, soccer, tennis, boxing, football. It never stops. The images that are thrown at you 24/7, and then you wonder why you can't memorize the Quran. And then a person says, why can't I memorize the Quran? Why don't I want to memorize the Quran? Why am I dropping out of the Quran class? And why this person who lives in India, or this person who lives in Gambia, or this person who's in the Far East has memorized Kutub Sitta by heart? Are you not a human being? Is his blood different than your blood? Is his DNA different than yours? Is he a different type of creation? Why can he memorize so easily, so simply? And why is it so hard for you to memorize 40 hadith? Because you have pictures, 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 images, images, images. And we didn't get into the haram. Ibn Qayyim, this third point, he didn't say looking at the haram. He says, itlaq al-basar, looking at everything. And if you don't believe this, or you think this is an exaggeration, then go to some of the Muslim countries. And from the most well-proven techniques of memorization is doing what? When someone wants to memorize something, he turns and he sits in the corner. He turns his back, he takes his mushaf, he rocks back and forth, and he sits in the corner. Alaysa dhalika dhalik. Why not? Is it haram to look at the brothers in the masjid? Is it haram to look at the colors, the paintings, the calligraphy? But sitting in the corner allows you to focus and allows your mind to concentrate. So just think about, from the time in which you wake up in the morning, from the time in which you go to sleep, how many images come past your eyes? Do you know what the specialists say? How long it takes an image to leave your mind, your brain, quote unquote, how many years it takes for one image that you saw for a few seconds to leave your mind? So just add that one image, 100, 1,000, a year, 5 years, 10 years. In other words, why is your computer moving so slow? Why is the computer moving slow? Because you have too much what? You have too much what? And you need to do what with the computer? And not format. Free some space. It's too crowded, too cluttered. Everybody understand this? Let alone viruses on the computer. Let alone harmful programs on the computer. Things that aren't viruses, but it's too much, it's too cluttered. And this is golden advice to the Tulab al-Ilm. You can't be a true student of knowledge if you look at everything and anyone. You can't be a true memorizer of the Quran if you look at everything and anything. You can't be a true student of Hadith if you look at anything and everything. Talk about anything and everything. Listen to anything and everything. Because these are all things that reach one's qalb. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, الرابعُ أنه يقوي القلب ويفرحه كما أن إطلاق البصر يضعفه ويحزنه. The fourth fa'ida is that lowering the gaze strengthens the heart and it causes happiness and joy. And looking at everything weakens the heart and it causes sadness. Is this something that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah made up, conjectured, put together? Read what the specialists and therapists and psychologists, read what these people say about those who watch pornography and how it is a major reason behind suicide. And it makes a person depressed. It makes a person sad and blue. It makes a person feel low. They get high, they get high, they get high, they get excited. And the moment they reach their climax, they're low and they feel like nothing. Don't take it from the Muslims. Don't take it from Ibn Qayyim. Read what the non-Muslim specialists say about this concept of feeling depressed and feeling low. So when we talk about the Muslim youth, challenges of 2016, sexual education, sexual awareness, this is going to be a starting point. Son, what do you watch? What are you watching, son? What are you listening to? What are you doing? How do you spend your free time? Why do you feel depressed? Why do you feel so low? Why do you lack confidence so much? Where does confidence come from? Where does strength come from? Except from the what? The heart. And that's why that brave man who wasn't a Muslim, but he was extremely brave, and he was skilled in war, they gave him the title of what? A lion heart. He had the heart of a what? Of a lion. His strength, his courage came from his limbs, came from his skill, came from his what? Came from his heart. Someone is brave, we say he has what? He says he has heart. We don't say he has courage. We say he has what? He has heart. In other words, he has shuja'ah, and the shuja'ah comes from the what? Come from the heart. From the harms of looking at everything, it makes you, and it turns you into a coward. It turns you into someone that has no self-esteem. And this is something that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala spoke on hundreds of years ago. Ibn Qayyim, he then says, Al-Khamis, the fifth benefit, أَنُّهُ يُكْسِلْ قَلْبَ النُّورَ أَوْ نُورًا كَمَا أَنَّ إِطْلَاقَهُ يُكْسِبُهُ ظُلْمَةً وَلِهَذَا ذَكَرَ سُبْحَانَهُ آيَةِ النُّورِ عَقِيبَ الْأَمْرِ بِغَضِ الْبَصَرِ. Number five, lowering the gaze gives the heart light. It gives the heart nur. And the opposite is the opposite. Not lowering the gaze causes the heart to be black, causes the heart to be dark. And this is the secret behind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about nur after he gave two commands. Commands to the men and commands to the women. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ tell the believers who are men. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ tell the believers who are female to do something. And the very first thing that he told them is not to avoid zina, not to wear hijab, not to get married. That's not what he told them initially. يَغُضُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ to lower their gaze at times and from certain things. After Allah Azza wa Jalla spoke on the ruling of lowering the gaze. وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجُهُمْ protect their chastity, cover up, screen yourself, avoid these vices of your sexual desires and lusts. ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ Allah says, because that is pure for them. That is pure for them. And not lowering your gaze, not protecting your chastity, not covering up, not being modest in how you dress, pornography. These things are considered to be filthy. They're dirty. That's why Allah says, ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ it is pure for them. And if you can't take the purity, if you can't take the faida, if you don't have enough inspiration to do the khair, know one thing for sure, that Allah Azza wa Jal, khabirum bima yasnaun, that Allah is aware of that which they do. Al-ihsanu an ta'budu Allah, fa'in lam takun tarah fa'innahu yaraka. If you can't worship Allah as though you see Allah, if you don't make the initiative to Allah, then at least know that what? Allah sees you. If you can't lower your gaze and protect yourself because it's better for you, because it's pure for you, then at least realize that Allah Azza wa Jal is aware of that which you do. And then He, the Most High, He addressed the females. He addressed the women. He addressed the sisters, the mothers, the daughters. No one to think that it's just for men to do. وَقُلِّ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَاحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ Allah says, and tell the female believers to do the exact same. Lower their gaze, not to look at everything, and to protect their chastity, and to dress modestly. Then Allah Azza wa Jal, He speaks on the rulings of them exposing their charms. Who is the mahram? Who is the mahram? Who they're married to, their fathers, etc. And then after all of these ayat, or these two ayat here, after all of these detailed pieces of ruling, Allah Azza wa Jal, He says that Allah is something, and He speaks on something, and He talks of the similitude of that thing. And that thing was nur, was light. Rather, that's the name of the chapter. And the beginning of the chapter says nothing about nur. The end of the chapter says nothing about nur. Towards the middle of the chapter, it doesn't speak about nur. This one piece, this one selection of the entire chapter was the reason why the entire surah was called Surah An-Nur. So Ibn Qayyim, he says, lowering the gaze brings nur into the heart. Just like looking at everything and avoiding lowering the gaze brings darkness to the heart. And that is the secret behind Allah Azza wa Jal mentioning that ayah in that place. He says, ثُمَّ قَالَ إِثْرَ ذَلِكَ اللَّهُ نُورُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مَثُلُ نُورِهِ كَمِشْكَاتٍ فِيهَا مِصْبَاحٍ He says, Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. And the similitude, the likeness of His nur is like that of a niche inside of a burning lamp. A مَثَلُ نُورِهِ فِي قَلْبِ عَبْدِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِ He says, the similitude of His light in His believing slave's heart. أَلَذِ امْتَثَلَ أَوَامِرَهُ وَاجْتَنَبَ نَوَاهِيَهُ He says, the believing slave who obeyed Allah, who complied to His commands and avoided His prohibitions. He then says, وَإِذَا اسْتَنَارَ الْقَلْبُ أَقْبَلَتْ وُفُودُ الْخَيْرَاتِ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ كُلِّ جَانِبٍ كَمَا أَنُّهُ إِذَا أَظْلَمَ أَقْبَلَتْ سَحَائِبُ الْبَلَاءِ وَالشَّرِّ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ He says, and when a person turns towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his heart is enlightened, his heart becomes luminous, becomes vibrant, becomes brilliant, becomes bright, he says, then all good will come to him. And when his heart turns away from Allah and it's dark, it's dim, it lacks life, it lacks a nur light, he says, then all shar will come. Let's just stop and let's think about 2016 and the Muslim youth. Read the testimonies, read the articles, read the books of those who came addicted to internet pornography, how they dropped out of school, how they stopped eating, how they didn't drink properly, they didn't sleep correctly, they had mental illness. I broke up with my girlfriend, I lost my wife, I lost this, I this, and I had so much opportunity in a worldly life, not the deen, but when I became a slave of my desires, when I started looking at everything, listening to everything, enjoying everything, I lost all of those things. And as we said, once again, don't take this just from what? Ibn Qayyim. Read what the non-Muslims say and how I wish I could have my life back. I wish I could go back 10 years, 20 years when I was married, when I had beautiful children, when I had a scholarship to play sports. I wish I was strong. I wish I was this. But it all went down the drain because I wasn't mindful of that which I looked at. Because my father, he was affected. He was poisoned. He had these filthy things in his house and they were accessed by me. And the list goes on. He was abused. He was molested. This person was mentally sick and perverted. His son, his daughter. And then it continues. And all shar, he says all evil, sahaib al-shar, all evil, it comes from the person not lowering his gaze. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, فَمَا شِئْتِمْ مِنْ بِدْعَةٍ وَضَلَالَةٍ وَاتِّبَاعِ هَوَنٍ He says, anything that you can possibly think about, innovation, misguidance, following your desires, being astray, being lost, being ignorant, he says, you can only fight and combat these things if you have the nur. If it's dark outside, if it's foggy outside, you do what? You put on your what? What do you do with your car? How can you see in the dark when it's dark outside you drive unless you have what? High beams or fog lights. You need a strong type of light that is going to pierce through the darkness. And if not, you walk into a tree, you crash into a tree, you fall off the side of the road. And this is a physical concept that is applied metaphorically as well. If you don't have nur in your heart, you'll fall for anybody. You'll listen to anything. You'll follow any group. People, they ask all of the time, how do I know who's on the sunnah? How do I know who's on the haq? How do I know what website to visit? What masjid to go to? Who to sit with? Who to study? And most people, they say, if they say this, if he studied there, if he talks about this individual, if he frees himself from fulan, if he knows fulan, and they deal with the ashi al-mur sathiyya, the things on the surface. But how many people say, have you lowered your gaze? You want to know who's on the truth? You want to know who's upon the falsehood? Let me see your phone. Let me see your internet history. Who's on the truth? Who should you listen to? Now, this is a reality. If you don't have no nur in your heart, then you'll fall for anyone's gift and anyone's gab. And only Allah knows how many people we've seen come and go. One day sheikh, one day scholar, one day imam, one day alama, and the next day bid'ah, hizbiyah, misguided, so on and so on and so on and so on and so forth. You don't think that Allah Azza wa Jal has the ability to allow you to see through this, through lies, through games? But if you're looking at things which you shouldn't be looking at, then you're going to fall into misguidance. So this shows us how lust, how desires will lead you to falling astray in al-Islam. And a student of knowledge cannot distinguish between the truth and the falsehood unless his heart is enlightened. And the heart cannot be enlightened except through, by, and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn al-Qayyim, he says, As-sadisu, annuhu yurithu al-firasata al-sadiqa, alati yumayizu biha bayna al-muhiqi wal-mubtil, wal-sadiqa wal-kathib, wa kana shuja'an al-kirmani yaqul, man ammara zahiru bi-tiba'a sunnah, wa batinu bi-dawami al-muraqaba, wa ghadda basaru an al-maharim, wa kaffa nafsu an al-shahawat, wa a'tada akla al-halal, lam tukhti lahu firasa. The sixth benefit is lowering the gaze. It strengthens, it fortifies, it allows you to have a quote-unquote third eye, a sixth sense, which we call firasa. And there are many special terms and ways of translating this word that we don't want to mention right now. But the concept of having an extra sense, a divine or divinely inspired intuition in which you can see things, feel things, and distinguish things that the normal person cannot. That's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shuja' al-Kirmani, he said, man ammara zahirahu bittiba' sunnah. He says, those who follow the sunnah in public, outwardly. That's number one. Wa batinahu bidawamin muraqaba. And when behind closed doors, you realize that Allah is still watching you. Allah still sees me. Allah still hears me. I'm not in front of the people anymore. I'm not in public anymore, but I still have to follow the sunnah and avoid the haram and perform and do that which is mandatory. Number three, وَغَضَّ بَصَرُ عَنِ الْمَحَارِمِ. And he who lowers his gaze from looking at that which is unlawful. وَكَفَّ نَفْسَهُ عَنِ الشَّهَوَاتِ. And he holds himself back from lust and from desires and from base whims. وَعْتَادَ أَكْلَ الْحَلَالِ. And he always eats from that which is lawful. Whether it's the zabiha, or whether it is the food that's purchased with lawful means that are tayyib. Many Muslims, it's about halal, zabiha, you can't eat this, it has alcohol in it, kather and kather and kather, which is true. But then they forget that I deal with riba. I sell things that are haram. My company steals wealth. It steals resources from poor, weak countries. And they think that the halal, zabiha food that they eat is tayyib. No, your rizq has to be tayyib from both aspects. And if it isn't, then you're not eating the halal on a constant basis. He says, those who do all of these things, لَمْ تُخْتِي لَهُ firasa. He says his intuition, his sixth sense, his third eye, when he looks at something, he can distinguish and make a criterion, it would never ever be inaccurate. He will always be right. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the power of the firasa. And only those of Allah's slaves who have experienced it, who have seen it, or maybe been given some of it, know the power and the benefit of having firasa. To distinguish between a liar and someone who's truthful. To distinguish between someone who's hiding something, says, what does he have under his fingernails? And as someone who's deceived and tricked and duped by the outward appearance of righteousness. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, Allah the Sublime, the Exalted, Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala yajzi al-abda ala amalihi bima huwa min jinsi amalihi. He says, Allah gives you based off of what you did. You reap what you sow. If you lowered your gaze, if you protected your sight, if you didn't look at everything that you weren't supposed to look at, Allah will give you something that is similar to the fight and the struggle that you made. So you held your eyes back in one place, so Allah Azza wa Jalla allows you, your eyes to be open in another place. And then Ibn Qayyim, he talks about the people of Lut, wal-iyadu billah. He says, those whom Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned two things about them, two things about the people of Lut. He says here, وَضِدُّ هَذَا مَا وَصَفَ اللَّهُ بِهِ اللُّطِيَّةِ مِنَ الْعَمَهِ الَّذِي هُوَ ضِدُّ الْبَصِيرَةِ فَقَالَ تَعَالَى لَعَمْرُكَ إِنَّهُمْ لَفِي سَكْرَتِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ فَوَصَفَهُمْ بِالسَّكْرَةِ الَّتِي هِيَ فَسَادُ الْعَقْلِ وَالْعَمَهِ الَّذِي هُوَ فَسَادُ الْبَصَرِ. He says that Allah describes the people of Lut with two things. لَعَمْرُكَ, swearing by the life of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, إِنَّهُمْ, these people, those who denied and rejected Lut, who were performing these horrible, atrocious acts, sakratihim ya'mahoon. He says they are drunk, they are intoxicated, ya'mahoon, wandering blindly. So Allah mentioned two things about the people of Lut. Number one, he says sakra, and number two, ama. Sakra, he says, fasad al-aql, is the destruction of the mind, is the sickness and the illness of one's mind. You're drunk, you're high, you're twisted, you're bit. Your mind is in what? It isn't in the right state, it isn't there. And then he says, ama. He says, actual blindness of the eye. And one thing doesn't necessarily lead to the next. Because there are people who are mentally ill, but they can still see correctly. They can still distinguish with their eyes. And there are those who may see things correctly, but their minds aren't there. So he says that the people of Lut, they had this double vice right here. He says they were what? They were drunk and they were blind. So if you look at everything, and it allows no doubt when we talk about the modern day challenges, addiction to internet pornography, it is an addiction. You become addicted, you become stuck. 5 minutes turns into an hour turns into 3 hours, 3 hours turns into a whole day. One site turns to another. I don't like this, this is disgusting, that's too extreme. And then the next thing you know, you realize and you look up and nothing is extreme anymore. Nothing stimulates you anymore. So you go further and further and further, and then comes the challenge of homosexuality. Then comes the challenge of pedophilia. Then comes the challenge of children, of bestiality. And before you know it, your soul is lost. Your soul is gone. One woman, another woman, one girlfriend, one-night stand, one person, one man, one date, one this, one that, just try it out. And the next thing you know, you slept with how many people? The next thing you know, your life, your soul is gone, it's destroyed. And there's nothing left. And it all started from the eyes. Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, As-sabi'u, he says, the seventh fa'idah, أَنُّهُ يُرِثُ الْقَلْبَ ثَبَاتًا وَشَجَاعَةً مُقُوَّةً يَجْمَعَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بَيْنَ سُلْطَانِ الْبَصِيرَةِ وَالْحُجَّةِ وَسُلْطَانِ الْقُدْرَةِ وَالْقُوَّةِ كَمَا فِي الْأَثَرِ. طيب, he says, the seventh fa'idah is that it causes the heart to be firm. It causes the heart to be brave. It causes the heart to be strong. And a person has the strength of his eyes, the strength of his mind, and physical strengthness, physical strength, both. A person can speak the truth, see the truth, and defend and enforce the truth. Moving forward, because we're running out of time. الثامن, أنه يسد على الشيطان مدخله من القلب, فإنه يدخل مع النظرة وينفذ معها إلى القلب أسرع من نفوذ الهوى إلى المكان الخالي, فيمثل له صورة المنظور إليه. ويزينها ويجعلها صنما يعقف عليه القلب ثم يعده ويمنيه ويوقد على القلب نار الشهوة ويلقى عليه حطب المعاصي التي لم يكن يتوصل إليها إلى آخر كلامي رحمه الله. Number 8, it causes the slave to be protected from the breath gate of the devil. Shaitan's madkhal, his means of entrance, his means of penetration. He says when Shaitan enters one's heart, and he gives the person a sonam, an idol, in which he sits in front of, and he obeys and he worships, like we mentioned last night. Ibn Qayyim died hundreds of years ago before there was an internet, before there was this magazine, before there was all the different things that we know exist today. He says this is what the shaitan does. He says, and the shaitan moves to someone's heart faster than the speed of wind, faster than air moving through an open space. When we have air in an open space, what takes place? The wind, sound, light, and the list goes on. Things that move because there's no obstacle. He says this is the concept of lowering the gaze and not lowering the gaze. Moving on, because we're running out of time, obviously. التاسع, أنه يفرغ القلب للفكرة في مصالحه والاشتغال بها واطلاق البصر يشتت عليه ذلك ويحول بينه وبينها فتنفرط عليه أموره ويقع في اتباع هواه وفي الغفلة عن ذكر ربه قال تعالى ولا تطع من أغفلنا قلبه عن ذكرنا واتبع هواه وكان أمره فرطا واطلاق البصر يوجب هذه الأمور الثلاثة بحسبه. Number 9, it causes a person to be heedless from thinking and reflecting about that which is beneficial. Thinking and reflecting about that which is beneficial in the deen or in the dunya. Your responsibilities, you become irresponsible. You lose track of time, you lose track of appointments, you lose track of dates, you lose track of deadlines when you look at every single thing. Last but not least, العاشر أن بين العين والقلب منفذا أو طريقا يوجب اشتغال أحدهما عن الآخر وأن يصل. طيب, he then says number 10 is the eye is connected to the heart, as we have previously mentioned and previously explained. Obviously a topic like this needs more time, needs more attention. It's something I wanted to share with myself, remind myself of, educate myself regarding, and also my brothers and sisters for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hopefully, by Allah's permission, we'll have another opportunity to discuss this in more detail and make some more real-life examples. And never underestimate the concept of what people watch, all right? The concept of what people watch in 2016 and how that is one of the main tools of the shayateen from the humans, from the demons, with regards to misleading Muslim youth and with regards to keeping non-Muslim youth from accepting Islam. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وجزاكم الله خيراً.